limitations, and from thy pure substance of love, bring into manifestation our world according to thy perfect law.
Close your eyes. Or if find a place to look at it, or to enjoy, you know, one of those, but just be right here with us now. In this space, all is well. In this moment, all is well. So one more deep breath with me, deep conscious breath, bring all of that knowing in, and release any doubt that that's not true. And with your next regular breath, again, breathe in gratitude, knowing that all is well. Our prayers are heard and answered. And release any tension, any worry, any anxiety that came before this moment. Come to this quiet space, turning our attention from the outside inward. Remembering that right where we are, God is. And all is good. If things come to mind and if you doubt that truth, just acknowledge them, thank them for the adventure, for the knowledge, for the experience, and return back to your heart space. Or remember the truth that God is everywhere present. God is right where we center our prayers. God is right where we are in this space. So imagine that bright light is coming down from the top of your head and cleansing your thoughts of any worry, any anxiety, any fear. Moving down through your body, through your neck, through your shoulders, through your back, where you're holding any physical tension. And just see that bright light moving all the way down through the bottom of your feet into the earth. Where it can be turned, transformed into only good. And then from the bottom, the core of the earth, from the bottom of your feet, bring up that transformed energy, that light, that love back through your body and blessing. Blessing your body with ease and comfort, blessing your mind with peace, moving back to the top of your head, connecting you to all that is beyond the universe. Connected to God everywhere present. Now one more time, bring that bright light down to the top of your head and into your heart space and send it out from you to your family, to your friends, to your community, to your co-workers. And then a little further out around the earth, around the world, touching each heart, each mind, each person wherever they are. Right where they are, in peace. And then bring that right back into your heart. Receive all that loving energy, that peace, that global center back into you, into your center. And feel the powerful presence within you. The presence that never leaves you. The presence of peace, of love, that presence that you are. Remembering that right where you are, all is well. And one more time, take one more collective breath together and feel the energy in this room as one. Breathing in gratitude for this space, for this sacred space, and this sacred community. And as you exhale, just release love and allow it to ripple out from you into the world. And imagine with me. A world where we all remember that all is well. A world where we remind one another what we forgot. Just for a couple more breaths, embrace that world, bring that vision into your heart. Imagine what it would look like to remember that truth as you move through the peaks and the valleys. As you face the joys, troubles. Remembering that that love, that peace is yours to accept, yours to choose at any time. Imagine a world. And as we begin to bring our attention back to this space, this moment when we open our eyes and look around, bring that truth with you into this space. of the world and look around and see if you can see it right here, right now. A world where we work to remind each other the love that we are, the good that we are, and the presence of spirit within us right here. One more deep breath. Just rest into the joy of that night. And say with me, our meditation responds as we take that into our heart. title. And I'm in the middle of class and I send it back and it may have sounded a little wonky. Sure, okay, I love it, I'll run with it. I can't wait to see what you come up with. What would you do if you were brave? Would you do it anyway? So June is World Roller Coaster Appreciation Month. And when I read that, I'm like, oh, can you imagine appreciating the peaks and the valleys? Oh, man. Because so many people are afraid. We all become afraid at different times. I feel like I'm bouncing off microphones. Let's turn this one off. Is it just me? Is it me? There we go. Did that help? Alright. You know, life is like a roller coaster. It does, it has ups and downs. But the truth is, it's your choice to scream or enjoy the ride. So there's this unpredictable nature about life, right? But the importance is about personal perspective and resilience. Do you want me to turn around?
No, just pull your thing up higher.
Better? Does that feel better? Okay. It must be not that important. There's the message. The only thing we have control over is us, right? To choose to scream or to enjoy the ride. And sometimes enjoy the ride means going like this, right? But we can still be in the moment. The ups and downs is just the victories, the defeats, the joys, the sorrows. It's all included. It's not one or the other. And so often when we're facing a struggle or someone near us is maybe going through grief or a challenge of some sort, we tend to dim our light because we feel like maybe we shouldn't shine when someone else is sad. Or we think maybe we can't enjoy this when we're sad. And yet it really is both and. I was in the drugstore a couple years ago and my wallet had a palm tree on it and it said, choose happy. You know, after you've had something for a while, you don't pay any attention. And the cashier, she said, oh, I love your wallet. Too bad that's not possible. And I said, what? Because I'm not tuned into my wallet at the moment. She said, well, you can't just choose happy. I said, well, sure you can. She said, how? I said, well, there's something going on that you have to work on that's maybe not going right. When you fix that, are there also things going right? Yeah. I said, then when you do what you have to do to get this going the way you want it, focus a little bit more on this. And all she said was, huh. That was the end of our discussion. What I want to give to you, that little bit of huh. Because hopefully that was a seed planted for her, right? There's tremendous power in choice. That's the key word, is choice. Think about the choices you made. It really emphasizes your individual response to life. Whether you're facing challenges with courage, or, you know, we get to learn from setbacks if we choose. Or we get to resist them, and how much harder is it when we resist? It could be that one family member at the annual reunion that you just know is coming, and they haven't even shown up yet, and maybe you haven't seen them since last year, and you're already feeling that in you. You're annoyed with them, and they complain hasn't even landed yet. Right? There's someone who knows one right here. You have one of those family members, right? But it's really about empowering yourself to choose who you will be in that moment, how will you show up. Because you have a choice. We can't change other people as much as we'd like to, and as much, oh, would the world be a beautiful place if everybody did it our way? Wouldn't that be fabulous? If I knew how to make that happen, we wouldn't even need to be here because everything would just be right. But the truth is there's resiliency and positivity as one of our choices, or resistance and that conflict. And where is that usually but in here? Because often we don't take the opportunity to work through it in a healthy way. We just allow it to fester and create tension. Even notice when you're feeling stressed about even the thought of something that you suddenly start holding it in your body. Think about a roller coaster ride. Now, I personally love roller coasters. I haven't been one in a few years, and I suspect it may continue to feel different as I get older. That's what I felt last time I was there. I'm like, well, that hurts a little now. But I still loved it, right? Do you hold on, or is there one that's like, woo! Anybody here do this? I tend to be that person. And even if I'm scared, I'm like, well, hold on, I have a seatbelt on, there's bars over my shoulders, I'm good. Or maybe it's just that holding on to that little bit of, and all of that is okay because you're in it. You're in it for the thrill, right? And then there's some people that are so terrified, and yet they do it anyway. And they end up enjoying it. I heard a celebrity talking some years ago at a video about one night, and a group of friends, they had had a little bit too much to drink, and somebody said, "Yo, we should go skydiving." And of course, in that moment, they're like, "Yeah." Well, this person was one of those proactive people and actually scheduled it for them, like booked it. And so, you know, when it's getting closer to time, like, wait, we weren't serious. And so this week and 2 weeks before, there was so much panic and fear in him. Then he's like, "I can't believe it. I don't want to back out. I don't want to look like that person, but I don't. I'm so scared. Scared of honey, scared. Like, why would you jump out of a perfectly good trip, you know, plane? And what am I doing?" But his pride got in the way, and he didn't want to back out. He wanted to look like, you know, the scary cat. So he did it anyway. And he said that week and a half, 2 weeks of fear and anxiety was where the struggle was. Because, you know, of course they have a professional strap to the back and the whole bit, you know, so the minute it happened, it was pure joy. And even if, you know, there's no shame in going, "Hey, I changed my mind." You know, that was an option too, but he chose to do it anyway. And often for us, that is where our suffering is here. It's before it ever happens, if it even happens. Because most of us are afraid of something that may never even take place. We are tremendous storytellers. You know, we come up with these stories like, okay, either we embrace the journey and we come up with this magnificent view of how it's going to turn out and what it's going to be like, and it's so exciting when we do it that way. But often we're like, "Oh my goodness, what if it goes wrong?" You know, "Oh, I have a flat tire on my car," and then all of a sudden we're imagining, you know, an accident on the freeway, losing our job and living under a bridge. It's like, but just put air in the tire. Like, we don't need to spiral in that story, right? It's not that big. We've all done it in moments. So when we're afraid, I do believe fear serves a purpose. I don't think we should just completely dismiss fear. Fear says look both ways before you cross the street. Fear doesn't say never cross the street, never leave the curb. So it's to be aware of, but also there's personal responsibility in that. And what choice are you making? In those peaks and those valleys, we have moments where we're like, "Oh my gosh, everything's bad." And then we start taking it out on everyone else. But yet in those valleys, there's something to be had. That's the point where you think of some of the biggest tragedies in life or in the world. That's the moment where people show up, where they support, where they love. And are you choosing to be that person? Are you choosing to be in that place of just recognizing the gift that is right there? Because whether it be maybe loss, and loss isn't always when someone passes away. Loss can be the end of a relationship. It can be the end of a job. Maybe, you know, transition. When your kids move out. When my kids became adults and moved out of the house, I thought, "Oh, who am I without them?" And that can really feel like a family as well. When you're there, you can look at it as like, "I don't know what I'm going to do with myself. This is terrible. Nothing can get worse." Or you can look at it from that way. What next? What can I take from this? You can be in the gratitude for what came before or what led you to that point. Or you can resist it and be stuck in your story for a really long time afterwards. I have really had opportunities to see people go both ways with it. I have met someone who was so hurt at the end of the relationship that when I met her, it was 19 years later, and she was still very angry and resentful at people in general. And it was so fascinating to hear the story. And I didn't hear the 19-year part until the end of the story. So it was like this sympathy and this empathy around it, and then a little bit of, so today also happens to be Let It Go Day. And in that moment, I want to break out into a song. but that's your choice. You can hold on to the pain, to the anger, to the resentment, to the resistance. Or you can choose to let it go and see what good is there as well. Because again, it's always both hands. So that quote, "Life is like a roller coaster," it's a reminder that you have a choice of your own perspective. You have a choice to resist or be resilient. To choose your attitude as either positive and navigating through life's uncertainties, or to be angry, which then affects everything in your life. You ever had one of those days where you woke up on the wrong side of the bed and, oh my gosh, this day's gonna suck, and then it does? Because you went out there expecting it, right? Whatever we go looking for is what we find. If we are afraid, and some, you know, the peaks and the valleys, we're afraid of both. You know, there are times, I can't tell you how often I've heard somebody go, I don't know, I'm a little nervous, things are going too right. It's like, what? Really? Well, the other shoe's about to drop. It's bound to any moment. It's like, I don't know about you, but I like two shoes. They're both included, right? So what if we just embrace it? In fact, let's take it to the next step and appreciate it, the roller coaster. You know, I laugh at our reactions to life. You know, summer, it's officially summer, and man, did Mother Nature show up, right? I went down to Unity Village this past week. It was expected to be in the 90s, almost 100. And then I was getting complaints from here that, like, somehow it was my fault that it was also hot here. But she goes out when it gets hot here. And it's funny, we're all winter, we can almost not bear it anymore. And then suddenly it's warmer. And then it gets a little too warm, and then we're unhappy about that. So we turn the air up so hot that our noses get stuffy. We all need sweaters to deal with what we've been wishing for when we require sweaters in the winter. So think about where you're at. Sometimes we go from one extreme to the other, and we don't know how to be not only in pain or sorrow or in a valley, but we also don't know how to be at the height of that peak. We don't know what to do with it when things get too good. Or then it goes just a little bit too far, and you're like, oh my gosh, now it's 95 degrees. Now I'd rather be freezing. Oh, now it's cold. Now I'd rather be hot. So tell me, do you scream, or do you enjoy the ride? And we all need to scream now and then. I mean, we all need that, right? There is a moment where you just need to let it out, and don't hold it in. But imagine what your world would be like, just yours, if you chose to appreciate the peaks and the valleys. The power of the month is imagination, or June. It is the ability to image, picture, conceptualize, envision, and dream. The affirmation for this month is, I envision good unfolding in every area of my life. So imagine what it would be like with your hands up in the air and the wind blowing on your face, and you're noticing, because it's all it requires is noticing good around you. Because it's always there. Even when you feel like you can't deal with one more whatever it is, one more word of that challenging person, one more day of the difficult job, one more heartache, one more unexpected bill, whatever it is. If you just look beyond that, can you deal with one more sunshiny day, one more flower blooming, one more friend that checks in to see how you're doing? Because when you look at the balance, almost the in here, if you look at that both and, then it makes the heavy stuff a little bit lighter. But we have to choose it. You have to decide whether or not you're going to make the best of it, whether or not you're going to be willing to even see the good. Because it's really easy. Just turn on the news, go out in the world, go to a real public event. Eventually, you'll see someone acting in a way that maybe terrifies you or annoys you. And if you look a little further, you'll see children laughing and couples falling in love and friends reminiscing. In the Peaceful Warrior book and movie, but in the movie, there's a moment, McNulty is, they call him Socrates in the movie. This young man is very flustered, and all he sees is everything that's going wrong. And then at a park, he says, be quiet for a minute, just look, what do you see? This young man's like, nothing. Driving a little hurt. And all of a sudden everything slowed down and he saw the person throwing the frisbee to their dog. And the new family was laughing, oodling over the baby. And the couple walking hand in hand. It's always there, if you're willing to notice. And one of the fundamental truths that we encounter early on in our quest in spirituality, especially in unity, is people say, everything works for good. Yeah. Sometimes it doesn't feel that way, right? But have you ever had those moments are many where you look back and you're like, well, in hindsight, I am so glad that relationship ended, or I got, you know, laid off from that job because it led me here. So we may not always feel it, we may not always see it, but it's always happening, and it can feel scary at times. But if you think about a roller coaster, now I know some will never get on one. It's funny, I don't care for Ferris wheels, which may seem completely ridiculous because they move slow. But I'm thinking that time to process the, you know, potential for what could go wrong.
Quite as well, because even when you don't believe it, God is still there.
God is everywhere, even if you don't believe God, right? Even if you are mad at God. And there's been moments, many of us have been like, come on, really? Why couldn't you do this different? I've had moments where I found myself, like, trying to debate with God. Imagine how that worked out. Like, let me be a compromise. And I'm open and willing, I surrender to you, but if you could just consider this option. And I'd help myself say that out loud, and then I could help them laugh, so I'm really advising God. Fantastic. But the truth is, who was I really advising? But me, myself, the presence within me, that might just consider knowing that I don't even know the how. And just instead having faith that all things are possible. And when we believe that, when we remember the I am truth of who we are rooted in that, which is universal, which is collectively true for all of us. So here about a word talks about something called creative serendipity. Serendipity is one of my favorite words. It's something that happens unexpectedly, that happens for the good, and it's just such a joyful word. But he said it is the positive use of the universal trend towards wholeness and order. The positive use of the universal trend. It's making practical the process of all things working together for good. Now, you may know this about me, but for me, it's not practical. Pretty words, I love it. I love music. I love poetry. Those are passions of mine. But if we don't put some feet on our prayers, if we don't take action, if we don't make it practical on how to implement in our lives, it's just beautiful to listen to, right? But how do we make this happen? He says, when you commit yourself to work with creative serendipity, you have a feeling that you have something working in you, something going for you, someone on your side, as it were, and you project a positive energy flow that will light your way. You then have the faith to believe that all things really are working for your good. So it's not about figuring out how to make them good. When you remember that truth, when you have that faith, you then radiate that from you. Kind of like when you're expecting that irritated family member to show up, you're radiating irritation. They haven't even gotten here, right? So I invite you to really look at what you have been choosing. You have to decide whether you're going to make the best of things or not. You get to choose how you show up, and how you show up then becomes your reality and your experience. So I invite you to please go with me for a moment. Get involved in this experience of imagery. Let's bring in that power of imagination. First, remember that Chinese navigation process. The compass composed of 5 points, north, south, east, west, and right where you are at. As the voice said to Abraham, look up from that place that you are. Northward, southward, eastward, and westward, all the land which shall seek to be, I will give it. That implies an experience of realization that Abraham knew where he was. But I invite you in this moment eternally to look southward, northward, eastward, and westward, and give thanks that all things are working for your good. All things work for good. Get in that vision right now. All things of your life, things that have come to you already, things that are still unfolding for you in the future. A part of all of this, all things working for good process, say to yourself, I'm in tune with this divine flow. And all things work together for good. I'm in tune with this divine flow and all things work together for good. In your mind's eye, see yourself going from this place today into the light of the world out there. See yourself taking steps, acting, serving, creating in a way that attunes you to the divine flow of your own good. Have faith that it goes beyond your conscious ability. Your experience, it touches upon one of the deep wellsprings of life, the spirit within you into the universal sense. The upward pull of the divine within your life is right here, right now, leading you into a higher and higher experience of expression and a fulfillment of healing wherever it's needed within you. All things working together for good, see yourself centered. Grounded in the middle of that compass right where you are. as the voice said to Abraham, lift up your eyes and look from the place that you are, northward, southward, eastward, westward, and you are in tune with that divine flow right in the center. In all the land that you see, all the success and achievement that you envision, all the healing, the overcoming that you imagine, feel that as the Lord, in this moment, you step right into it. This shall be yours. All things working together for good. And have faith. This divine process is always active in your life. Always, even in the deepest of valleys or the scariest of the peaks. Wherever you are, whatever you are doing, take that in. Welcome it into your experience. You're always in the center of the circle. All things working for good. When you believe it and even when you don't, you decree it. And you keep yourself in tune with it if you choose. So for just one more moment, look to those areas of your life where you have had something that you have let yourself believe is terrible, something that you have believed can't be fixed. Tragedy or loss, heartache, confusion, maybe a financial struggle. And lift up your eyes above and beyond that experience and be willing to declare, decree, and believe that all things, even there, even that, is working together for your good. And out of that point of darkness, just beyond that, out of that difficulty, out of that confusion, something wonderful shall come. Something beautiful. Like a splotch on the wall that could be transformed into something beautiful, the darkest points of your life may become a stepping stone to your crown and your glory. We just have faith, we just choose it. And we just remember that that's the real truth of who we are. And the truth shall make you free. Just remembering the truth of who you are and taking that extra step to remind others when they forget. So before we go into the Lord's Prayer, I would like to share with you a little tool for those moments when you're spinning, those moments when your mind can't even think straight. We all have them. When our emotions are like a tidal wave taking over. And this is a simple way not only to bring you into the present moment, but even if you're feeling anxious or worried. And now, I'll just preface this with reminding you that I'm the youth director. But I believe that our inner child of every age is always alive and well. So when you're struggling to be in the moment, your five senses can help you with that. So here's a little tool to bring you back to that space. And do this right now with me, even just in your mind. Think first, just high five, right? We just need a high five. Think of five things. Look around and think five things that you can see. Five things you can see, it requires you to be in this moment if you can see them. Four things that you can touch. Four things right now in this room that you can touch if you chose. Three things that you can hear. Two things that you can smell. And one thing that you can taste. Now don't look at it, but think of something in the other table or desserts outdoors that you can taste. When we tap into our senses, we come into this moment. And in this moment, right now, we're at peace. This is a moment where we are at choice. Where we have the ability to center ourselves and decide the next step, the next word, the next action. This space where we need to ground ourselves in faith and know that all really is well, that all is working in favor and our good. And in this moment, we can appreciate the roller coaster. Because every peak and every valley brings us something good. So who would you be if you were brave? My question to you. And are you choosing to scream or appreciate the ride? Because it's up to you.
Thank you.
right here, right where we are, the kingdom is what we choose to manifest. It's what we create. It's what we choose. So now is our time of tithes and offerings. I want to remind you that as we give up our time, our talent, our treasure, what we're doing is acknowledging God as our source. And what we give out to the world is what is pressed down, chained together, runs over, and returns to us. So be mindful of what you're putting out into the world. And as you give in here in this church, as you're tithing of your time and your talent and treasures, know that you're not just blessing these walls and keeping this beautiful community going, which you are, but you are, in that moment, offering gratitude to God for being your source that comes through many avenues, even those both that we didn't expect, even those that we weren't aware of. God is moving in and through and as you, blessing you and allowing you to receive from others. So as we bless our offerings today, just allow yourself to be in a state of gratitude for God as your source of all good. So if you join me in the offering statement, our divine love, through me, bless us and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. I give joyfully and easily for the universe. Bless these offerings that you place in the basket. We thank you, God, for this opportunity to give, to express our appreciation, our knowing that you are our source in all things, in all times, in all situations. We thank you for hearing our prayers, for blessing our offerings, and for reminding us that what we put out ripples out into the world, and we are so grateful to be a source of good, a source of God. And so it is. Amen.
Sing out loud. Sing out strong. holds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Go forth, take this loving, peaceful energy out into the world and enjoy the ride. And remind each other to do the same. Thank you.